Rock, for God's sakes, will you please shut the hell up? Alright, I'm gonna get ragged on this one. I'm gonna get 30,000 trolls this time, or one rock under 30,000 names, because obviously, that's very clear to me that that's who's been trolling me. It isn't a bunch of random people, it's the Rock. You know, he's gonna go on a whole insult rant. You know, this was funny 10 years ago, 15 years ago. It's childish now. 15 years ago, I was a teenager. I was 17 years old, 16 years old, 19 years old, whatever. I was in high school. I was a young adult. Your mom jokes and all of this other stuff was funny. It's not funny anymore. It's dumb. And maybe I'm getting old. Oh well, that's just the way it is. But still, my fucking God. First of all, the Rock had the lyrics right in front of him the entire time, and he's in there. Down, up, down, up. No wonder the Rock only had to play three chords. If he tried to do anything more and multitask further, his brain would explode. All right, I'm getting ahead of myself here on the Monday Night Raw review, but God, that went on forever. It was the same song five times with different lyrics, with really stupid jokes and insults that anybody who is a dipshit with a keyboard who can get out on YouTube and go, I'm gonna insult this guy, I'm so special. That's exactly how the Rock sounded. And then in the end, it was Raw, was Kareoke, with the Rock singing over top the actual version of We Will Rock You by Queen, and pretty much butchering it. And frankly speaking, I hope Queen sues the shit out of him. God, that was horrible. You know, of course, he's protected under copyright law, fair use, act, parody, all that kind of stuff. So, you know, same thing that protects me when I use footage here on my show. All right. Let's run down Monday Night Raw. Top to bottom, show was pretty good, except for The Rock's part. God, you know, I was actually thought The Rock's concert might be kind of funny, and there were a couple of parts that made me laugh, definitely, but for the most part, it was like being dragged through a pile of broken glass by my nose. And once again, I am under the opinion that although the live crowd reacted well to it, I think Cena outdid him again. And I know that's what it's meant to be, and maybe I'm being a mark on this, but I really enjoyed Cena coming out. I kind of got it off to the side here, the replaying Raw over here on my TV screen. And Cena comes out. Sean. There you go. Monday Night Raw. And we got some old-school Cena right there. Straight up, basic thugonomics. Cena comes out to the basic thugonomics. Now, I'm going to say that, you know, this was the Cena that a lot of us really liked a few years ago before he became, you know, the military jorts Cena. This version of Cena, all the fans cheered, and I was really kind of surprised that the audience didn't react better to this. I would have thought that they did. I know a lot of the home audience, the people I talked to on the web boards, certainly was reacting well to it. This, for me, is kind of akin to the same sort of thing of when Hulk Hogan was Hollywood Hogan for so long, and then comes back as the red and yellow Hogan. It's along the same lines. It's just sort of in reverse kind of thing. But you understand what I'm saying. We had a really straightforward rap from him that was very attitude era. I'm not going to use that word that Jericho invented and Michael Cole kept trying to get to trend worldwide on Twitter is attitudinal or whatever the heck word they were using. This was good. We had a solid match between Sheamus and, oh goodness, I'm sorry, I'm having a brain blank here. Who? Ziggler, that's right. I'm sorry. This whole springing forward thing has really thrown me off, so I'm really fucking tired. I maybe got like 3 hours sleep, wasn't it? How could you forget him? He's been bright pink. He just stands out. He felt pretty in pink. Yes, he went from being a cheerleader to pretty in pink. Good match. We had the announcement about now we're going to have a 12-man tag match at WrestleMania. Team Laurinaitis versus Team Teddy Long. Pardon me. Those two, we had a match where it was Mark Henry and Otunga versus Santino. Santino kind of got squashed. So we expected to add some dominance for Laurinaitis' team. We now know at least two official members of Laurinaitis' team. And, of course, there's Captain David Otunga and Mark Henry. And captain of the other team is Santino. From the rumor mill going, Team Long's team looks really, really, really bad and doesn't look very strong. I'm saying it's probably going to be a bit lopsided, to say the least. We had another confrontation between Teddy and John Laurinaitis, and Teddy lightly pushes him with his fingertips up, and John Laurinaitis sells it like Hulk Hogan just punched him straight in the skull and knocked him halfway across the ring. Johnny, this is not the finger poke of doom. You don't need to sell it like you're Shawn Michaels versus Hulk Hogan at SummerSlam, okay? Teddy Long is not that built and strong, okay? You don't have to sell it as if you're fighting The Undertaker. Speaking of The Undertaker, we had a great confrontation between Undertaker and HBK. There's some definite hinting at HBK possibly screwing The Undertaker. Undertaker basically said, if you fuck me, I'm gonna take you out. And HBK kind of patronizingly patted him on the arm. We had that sort of thing going on. And Triple H came out and told him to eat down at the Y. Yes, because Stephanie McMahon has his penis and balls in her purse. I'm going to get a lot of flaming on this video. And we get a nice up close of The Undertaker and his amazingly powerful pimple under his nose. Speaking of weird blemishes, just dating back to Sheamus versus Ziggler, man, that mark that got up the back of Sheamus was just brutal looking when he crashed into the announce table. Ugh, that just looked painful. And speaking on that match, was it really necessary to cut away from the action to have a conversation with Daniel Bryan and AJ? Couldn't you have done a split screen? I know they're capable of doing it. I know that it's just a reverse chin lock, and you know that's not for the most entertaining on television, but neither is staring at Daniel Bryan when we know a match is going on in the ring. We had a rather subpar match between Randy Orton and Jack Swagger. I'll be honest, I watched that match and it was just okay, and it ran a bit too long for my taste. And Jack Swagger, for the second week in a row, is sporting his new hairstyle, which makes him look like 1985 Biff Tannen. It's not exactly the best look on him. Maybe he's joined the JBL Hair Club for Men. I'm not sure. No sign of tag champs. No real things with Big Show or anything like that. We had a threatened confrontation between Kane and Randy Orton, but Kane didn't actually come out, so nothing really came from that. We had Miz versus CM Punk. James Rodé was making an appearance. I love Sykes. Sykes is a great show. Wish I had a television service so I could watch it. James Rodé did a okay ring announcement for the matchup. CM Punk beat The Miz in a decent match these two had, but the aftermath was great. Chris Jericho coming on the screen and dragging some real life into the confrontation where You know, while Punk has never made any bones about this, the fact that his father was an alcoholic and, you know, talking about the temptations to be an alcoholic, and that's really why CM Punk is a straight-edge wrestler, and it's the part of the reason why he is straight-edge in real life. And it's nice to see that kind of realism interjected, and it's nice to see Jericho doing what he's always done, which is tell a great story, not only in the ring, but on the microphone. It stepped us away from just run-ins and attacks on Punk and actually stepping up to playing a mind game so that this match becomes more than just, this was for the WWE Championship, I'm the best in the world, no, I'm the best in the world. A little more depth, a little more personal. And you could read whether or not, you know, Punk was just, you know, was really feeling the emotion, or if he was just drawing from that emotional place. You could see the pain and hurt on his face, and Punk spoke volumes with just the look on his face. And that in itself was probably the best segment on Raw. Besides the Roxa segment, the other bad segment was the backstage stuff with Eve and Zach, where they're going to be friends with STDs. Benefits. It's, you know, I know it's a character, I know it's a story, but come on, Zach. Don't be a fucking idiot. Overall, I would give 70% of Raw a solid A. The last 30% was a D. And, you know, I really could have done without hearing the same four songs over and over and over again. And I know what they're saying all over the news boards and like NoDQ, or they're saying The Rock is being designed to look bad so that Cena, so that they try to keep the audience even. So it'll be a 50-50 between The Rock and Cena when WrestleMania rolls around. They're going to try, they're going to force it, and so far in every speech moment, pretty much, Cena's kind of owned him. And while some people I've heard already have said they didn't like this Raw as much, overall, I found this Raw a heck of a lot more enjoyable than last week. But there is still one thing that I feel it's missing on this road to WrestleMania. Week after week, we've had, since Ron Simmons' announcement, we've had no new inductees into the Hall of Fame. Nobody else who's been announced, and that's a part of the road to WrestleMania that I've always personally enjoyed, to see who's going to get in, who's going to get inducted, and the fact that there haven't been over the last few weeks seems to be a very intricate part of the puzzle that I feel like I'm missing. I'm Mr. Spiffy, and I really need to get some sleep.